entertainers, facilitators, and all my fellow friends. Today, we would like to present to you our research, which titled The Relationship Between Physical Activity with BMI Among the First Year and Second Year of Medical Students of Faculty of Medicine. First and foremost, we want to thank all the lecturers of Department of Community Health, especially Prof. Asmi, our facilitator, Dr. Noor Fazila, and all the members of Lab 2 for their contributions in this research. Before we start our presentation, I would like to give you a brief intro about our study. So basically, our study is aimed to determine the relationship between gender, race, type, duration, and frequency of exercise with the BMI level. A cross-sectional study was used, the descriptive and analytics analysis was applied, and the chi-square test was used to determine the relationship between frequency and durations of physical activity with the BMI level. I would like to give you an introduction about what is BMI. So BMI is a simple index of weight for height that is commonly used to classify underweight, overweight, and obesity in adults. The formula for BMI is weight in kg over height in meter squared. We randomly choose 100 students from first year and second year medical students as our respondents, and the location of our study is in UKM's Terrace campus. Before we do our research, we have done some literature reviews. So what we found that according to American Journal of Health, we found that those who maintain a healthy weight were consistently more likely to engage in a vigorous physical activity. And also according to the Journal of American Medical Association, we found that there's a significant weight loss and improved cardiorespiratory fitness was achieved from the higher duration exercise compared to the other classifications. Problem framework, we are actually trying to find out the relationship with BMI with the demographic pattern, gender, race, age, and type, frequency, and duration of physical activity. The objective of our study is we want to determine the relationship between gender, race, type, duration, and frequency of exercise with BMI. The hypothesis is we think that the female students are likely to achieve a higher BMI than male. Chinese students are more likely to have a lower BMI compared to non-Chinese. Students who do vigorous exercise and moderate exercise will achieve a lower BMI. Students who exercise in a longer duration for both the vigorous and moderate exercise will have a higher BMI. Moderate exercise more than 4 times a week will help the students to achieve an higher BMI. Students who do a vigorous exercise more than 3 times a week will have an higher BMI as well. For methodology, we are using the cross-sectional study, which is the measure of relationship of variable in a defined population at one time. For operational definition, we classify the body mass index into 4, that's the high, low, ideal, and non-ideal. For the high is more than equal to 35 kg per meter square, and the low is less than 35. For ideal, it's within the range of 18 to 32.9, and the non-ideal is out of the range. For gender, we classify into male and female. For the race, it's Chinese, non-Chinese. For the frequency of exercise conducted, is high durations and low durations. And then for the durations of activity, is long durations and short durations. For the type, frequency, and the durations of physical activity, we are using the International Physical Activity Questionnaire Scoring Protocol, which the last revision date is at November 22, 2010. For the questionnaire, we are asking the respondent about the gender, range, physical activity, duration, frequency, and type of the exercise.
Assalamualaikum, very good morning. Thank you, Sam, for your assistance. Now I shall continue to the presentation of the next part, which is on the results and discussion, especially on descriptive analysis. So first and foremost, the number of respondents are actually 100 medical students that consist of or comprise of first year and second year medical students. And okay, the pie chart shows 50% of the medical students are male, while 51% are female. So yeah, the next one is the races. We divide the races into Chinese and non-Chinese, which the non-Chinese subdivided into Malay, Indians, and others. Next, on classification of the body mass index, we classify it especially to ideal and non-ideal. So from the pie chart given, it's proven that 57% of the medical students are ideal, they are having an ideal BMI, and 43% are non-ideal BMI. For the rigorous activity, you can see there are 56% of the medical students in first year and second year are more active or prone to rigorous activity than the non-rigorous than students. The first year and second students, which doesn't actually exercise in terms of rigorous activity or involve in it. So next, on frequency of the rigorous activity, as you can see, there are two bar charts here, which is a double bar chart. Students that actually, this actually shows the frequency of the rigorous activity against the percentage of the students. And it seems that 49% of the students are actually, they are exercised more frequently, three or more times, of using the rigorous activity, which is the type of activity, and it seems 32 out of 49% are actually having a more idea of BMI compared to the non-idea, which is 17%. Meanwhile, the students which is exercising less than 3 times in terms of rigorous activity per week is having a less idea of BMI compared to the idea, which is 26% compared to 25%. Okay, for duration of the rigorous activity, you can see. The medical students actually are exercising less than 60 minutes per day. So this is the result, which is 67%. And the moderate activity shows that the students are prone to exercise or practice by non-moderate activity compared to the moderate activity. And for the frequency of moderate activity, the students are actually prone to exercise or indulge themselves in this activity of more than 4 times per week, which is 58%, compared to the less than 4 times, which is 42%. For the duration of the moderate activity, students only 11 up to 89% actually exercise in less than 90 minutes. So without further ado, I shall continue to next result, which is on analytical analysis. So here I go. So for the Down hypothesis, there's no significant association between gender and BMI. And by using the t-test, this is the result shows, and it seems that the p-value is more than 0.05, which is proven to be insignificant, thus the null hypothesis is not rejected, and no significant association between the gender and BMI of those factors. Nonetheless, for the next one, the null hypothesis between the races and BMI, the p-value is less than 0.05, which is significant. Therefore, it is proven that the null hypothesis is rejected, and the Chinese students tend to have a lower BMI than non-Chinese students. You can check on the mean value, which is quite a large gap. Okay, next, on the null hypothesis, there is no significant association between the rigorous activity and BMI. So the p-value is more than 0.05, which is insignificant, thus the null hypothesis is not rejected. And there's no association between these two variables. Okay, still using the same t-test, but on different factors and relationships, on the association between the moderate activity and BMI. In this case, the p-value is less than 0.05, which is significant, and thus null hypothesis is rejected, and can be concluded that the students who do moderate activity will achieve a lower BMI within the medical students. So, okay, next one, by using the chi-square test, it seems p-value is more than 0.05, which is proven to be insignificant, thus the null hypothesis is not rejected, and can be concluded there is no significant association between the frequency of rigorous activity and BMI in medical students, or first year and second year medical students. Next, by using the chi-square test again, between the frequency and moderate activity and BMI, the p-value is more than 0.05, which is insignificant, so the null hypothesis is not rejected, and can be concluded that there is no significant association between frequency or moderate activity and BMI, as according to the result shows. So, the next one, on the duration of rigorous activity and BMI, the p-value shows a greater of more than 0.05, which is insignificant, and again, the null hypothesis is not rejected, and there's no significant association between these two variables, which is the duration of rigorous activity and BMI. Okay, on next one, there is the association between the duration of moderate activity and BMI. The p-value is more than 0.05, which is still insignificant, and the null hypothesis is then not rejected, and there's no association between the duration of moderate activity and BMI. Okay, moving on to the next part, which is the discussion. So, first and foremost, I'll begin on the significant relationship, which is more on the race and moderate activity with BMI. So for weight and BMI, there is a significant association, as I mentioned, because the Chinese students have a lower BMI than the non-Chinese students, which is our hypothesis accepted and also supported by a study conducted by Wasnai et al. Okay, within the journal given. So next, for the moderate activity and BMI, there is a significant association between the moderate activity and BMI, which is the body mass index. And this is because students who do moderate activity will achieve a low BMI, and it's supported highly, in all likelihood supported by this journal, which as you can see there, which is in Health Science and Medical Dietetics and Differences in the Most of the Types of Liquidity and Obesity Tested in U.S. Adults. Okay. So next, for the gender, the other factors that include gender, types of physical activities, and duration, and frequency of physical activities, there is no significant association between body mass index between these factors, associated with the body mass index, which is due to these limitations, as you can see, which is the first one is because of the small sample size. It reduces accuracy of the final outcomes, especially the results during our calculation. And we suggest that you should increase the sample size up to more than 100 students or sample size. Next, there's also a reliability and validity of the self-reported, which means the students will eventually underestimate their weight and overestimate their height because of we're not using any direct methods. So more direct methods should be used and utilized or harnessed in order to measure height and weight to get the more precision results. Next one, the cross-sectional study by conducting self-report measure questionnaire is not so significant because a longitudinal study, which is a longer term of study that is more substantial and thoroughly can determine the accurate and significant result which comes with the outcomes, especially the outcomes. So I think that's all for now. Thank you.